Good morning. Welcome to Beautiful Savior. The claim of Easter is pretty audacious. A man who was dead comes back to life. In fact, it was such a surprising claim that one of Jesus' own disciples had trouble believing it. This morning, we're going to be taking a look at what Jesus did to calm that man's fears and also what he does to calm ours as well. Everything that you need to worship with us will be found either on the PowerPoint slides behind me or in your service bulletins. And now, if everything is ready, come let us worship the Lord. We continue by hearing Wendy Diesler sing Alive.
Could breathe and leave a trail of galaxies and dream of me. What kind of love is writing my story till the end with mercy's pen? Only you. What kind of king choose to wear a crown that bleeds and scars to win my heart? What kind of love tells me I'm the reason he can't stay inside the grave? You, is it you standing before my eyes? Every part of my heart cries, alive, alive. Look what mercy's overcome. Death has lost and love has won. Alive, alive. Hallelujah, risen Lord, the only one I follow. I am his because he is alive. Who could speak and send the demons back from where they came with just one name? What other heart would let itself be broken every time till he healed mine? You, only you, could turn my darkness into dawn, running right into your arms alive. Alive. and love has won. Hallelujah, I am His because He is
alive. Please rise. We worship in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We join to confess our sins together. First, we sing hymn 141. Like Jesus' first disciples, at times we are filled with doubt, anxiety, and sadness, which can cause us to lose trust in God. We now confess our sins. Forgive us, Father. We trust in ourselves far too much. We are quick to doubt you. The sinful state in which we were conceived and born is forgiven by Christ, your Savior. Whatever sins have surfaced in your heart and mind, they are forgiven by Christ, your Savior. Do you resolve, with God's help, through word and sacrament, to change your sinful life in response to God's free, undeserved grace? If so, then answer, yes, as God gives me strength. We continue with our next hymn. You may be seated. This morning, God comes to us and feeds us through His Word. Our first reading is taken from Acts chapter 3. And we see in this section of Scripture what can happen to a person when they come in contact with the risen Christ. You'll remember that during Holy Week, Peter denied that he had known Jesus or had ever come into contact with Him. Now, after the resurrection, that same Peter is standing there boldly and confidently proclaiming what he knows to be true. And we read, Peter said to them, "Fellow Israelites, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us as if by our own power or godliness we had made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified His servant Jesus. You handed Him over to be killed, and you disowned Him before Pilate, though he had decided to let Him go. You disowned the Holy and Righteous One and asked that a murderer be released to you. You killed the Author of Life. But God raised Him from the dead. We are witnesses of this. By faith in the name of Jesus, this man, whom you see and know, was made strong. It is Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him that has completely healed him, as you can all see. Now, fellow Israelites, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did your leaders. But this is how God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, saying that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, then, and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord, and that he may send the Messiah who has been appointed for you, even Jesus. Here ends our reading.
Please stand. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." With that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Again, if you have forgiven anyone's sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. Now Thomas, known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks on his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord, my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord. Please be seated.
At this time, we will have the children's talk. Any children who are here in the congregation may come up, and we'll sit on this side. So if you want to come up, sit right over here.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I don't think this isn't very big, but there's something in the bottom of this bag here. Can you kind of see what it is? Would you like to guess?
Dirt.
It does look like dirt, but that's not what it is. Do you have an idea? It is, thank you. It's little tiny seeds. They're pretty small, aren't they? They look like just little pieces of dirt or little pieces of sand. If we wanted these little seeds to grow, what would we have to do to them? What's one thing? Before we even did that, though, where would we have to put them? Yes, we'd have to put it in dirt, either in the garden or in a pot, that's right. And then, like you said, you'd water it, and we would, and what? Oh, you raised your hand. Well, what else is going to, are we going to have then? We've got dirt, and we've got seeds, and we need something to shine from the sky. What would that be? Yeah. Okay, we need the sunshine, that's right. Yes, and we need to plant them in a sunny spot. Good, you must be gardeners. Oh, okay. Now, you and I have something in us. I'm going to call it a faith seed. And in order to make that faith grow, well, we're not going to plant ourselves in the ground, are we? Are we going to be... have somebody pour water on us and the sunshine, is that going to make our faith grow? No. So there's a different way for our faith to grow. In fact, right now, you're starting it. Where are you right now? You're in church. And who do we learn about when we're in church?
God.
We learn about Jesus. And what did Jesus do for us? He died on the cross for our sins so one day we can go to heaven. That's right. So we hear about Jesus, and what else do we do when we're in church? We were just doing it just a little while ago. Were we singing? Yeah, we the people in church, we were singing about Jesus. And when we fold our hands, what do we call that?
Praying.
Yeah, we pray to Jesus. That's right. When we do those things, the Holy Spirit comes into us, and we cannot see the Holy Spirit, but he comes into us, and guess what happens to our faith? It starts to grow, just like when we put that little seed in the ground and water it. But we have to hear God's word. We have to listen. We have to pray to him. And then when we do those things, the Holy Spirit rushes into us and helps our faith to grow. But here's something we have to remember. If I just keep my seed in this little plastic bag, is it ever going to grow?
No.
Never. It will never grow. And if we don't, every single day, if we don't talk about Jesus, if we don't hear about him, if we don't sing about him, if we don't pray about him, what could happen to our faith? Would it grow? No, it wouldn't. And that wouldn't be what God wants. He wants our faith to grow every single day. So let's remember that even when you're at home, ask mom and dad to tell you those Bible stories. Read your Bible, sing his praises, and pray. So let's fold our hands, close your eyes, and today I'll just say the prayer for you, and you can just be a listener. Help me, Jesus, every day to read your words and sing and pray. As my faith grows, I want to be a child of God that will honor thee. Amen. Now, when we leave, would you follow me in the back, and then I have something for you, okay? Thank you.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our sermon focus for this morning is on the words of John chapter 20, verse 29. Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, what is the opposite of faith? If I asked that question to someone on the street, what do you think they would say? The opposite of faith is reason. Thinking for yourself rather than blindly believing something that's obviously not true. Science? Having facts and experience to back up everything that you believe? Or maybe unbelief, getting too caught up in what you see in front of you instead of believing what in the unseen. So there's faith or reason, there's science or religious belief, and there's no middle ground there. That's how many people see it. But I want you to listen to two quotes. The first one gives the average person, the average religious person's view of what faith is. And the second one gives the average non-religious person's view of faith. So the first one was apparently something that Abraham Lincoln once said. He said, "To believe in the things you can see and touch is no belief at all, but to believe in the unseen is a triumph and a blessing." That illustrates this common view of faith as maybe something that is kind of a blind leap that we don't really need evidence to back it up. It's just something you believe. And the second quote is from a man named Matt Dillahunty who said, "Faith is the excuse people give for believing something when they don't have a good reason." And that illustrates a more disparaging view of faith, that reasonable people have no use for faith, have no use for belief. But I would argue, and this is not at all an uncommon argument, that both views are a version, a kind of faith. The one we might call blind faith. The idea that religious belief doesn't involve having reasons, having evidence. It's just a blind leap. You just gotta believe. The other we might call seen faith. That scientifically minded people always need experience, always need to see and experience things for themselves if they're going to believe something. Yet they're both a kind of faith, a kind of belief. They both have their problems. And if you don't believe me, just look at this, the story of our gospel reading. The disciples come to Thomas, this other disciple, who, after they have seen the risen Lord, the risen Jesus, and they say to him, "We have seen the Lord." And Thomas replies, unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were, unless I put my hand in his side, I will not believe." And at first, a reasonable person might see this as a win for the scientific approach, that the disciples demand faith and Thomas says, "Let me see him." At first, the religious person might see this or might disparage Thomas for his lack of faith, disparage him for wanting to see. They might say with Abraham Lincoln, "To believe in the things you can see and touch is no belief at all." But then what about the other disciples? Their faith wasn't blind. They had seen those nail marks. And they didn't expect Thomas to believe without any evidence. The evidence was that they had seen him themselves. No, it won't make sense unless you know that there's a third option here. There's a third kind of faith. It's a kind of faith that religious people should have, a kind that even scientists often rely on, as I'll explain in a minute. Kind that everyone really relies on. Not blind faith, not seen faith, but what we might call heard faith. To believe in something that someone else has seen and told you about. And it's something that we can't even function without. And here's what I mean. So in John's gospel, the Apostle John, he uses a word 47 times. Uses the word testimony or testify to tell his listeners exactly why it is they should believe what he's saying. There are reasons. There is evidence. Not that you can see, but it's that the people who were there, who saw what and heard Jesus, testify to that. And faith believes that testimony. That kind of faith also belongs to the study of history or geography or any kind of school subject. So I believe that the Civil War happened, and I don't think anyone would disagree with that. Not because any of us were there, but because the people who were there have said so. They said what they saw. I believe that Gettysburg is a real place where a real battle happened in that war, not because I've personally been there, but because I've heard stories, I've seen pictures. If I looked at a map, it would be there. And that kind of faith also is what scientists rely on. And that if it wasn't, every scientist would have to start from scratch. They would have to do every experiment themselves. But they don't. No, they rely on the work of past researchers, past experiments. So if you just think about it, think about everything that you believe that you have never seen or experienced for yourself, you'll realize that this is a very common type of faith. Of course, you can't believe everything that you hear. So for example, that quote from Abraham Lincoln earlier, if you look it up on the internet, you'll find that it might have been said by Abraham Lincoln, or it might have been made up by a man named Bob Proctor, who also says things like, "See yourself living in abundance and you will attract it. It works every time with every person." And I'm pretty fairly certain that he's actually the one who said both of those things. But the internet, it illustrates that problem, that there is so much out there to believe. How do we figure out what's true and what someone just made up? How do we know that the person we are listening to is reliable? Well, if it's a website, you might look at who published it. Is it Harvard University or is it your cousin's blog? Or if it's a person, how long have you known this person? Have they ever lied to you in the past? Would they have any reason to lie to you now? And what about Thomas? Should Thomas have believed what the disciples said when they said that they saw Jesus alive? Believed without seeing for himself? Well, yes. He should have. But he didn't. He wanted to see. And we can understand that. Who of us wouldn't want to see Jesus? But we must be careful not to demand more evidence than God has given us. Because what he has given us is enough. And what if Thomas, or what if Jesus hadn't appeared again? Would Thomas have gone on denying his Savior? Thankfully, that's hypothetical. Jesus did appear again. But see if you can't detect a note of warning in what Jesus said to Thomas. Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. And what do those words imply? So we may demand to see Jesus, but we're not going to get that wish. And if that's a condition of our believing, then when we do see him, it'll be too late. And he won't be commending our faith, but condemning our unbelief. And that is a scary thought. It is so easy to doubt. But Jesus' words weren't meant to be scary. They were meant to comfort us. Jesus knows how hard it is to simply hear and believe something that you've never seen. So let's not assume that Jesus has left us without evidence. No, the evidence is the people that were there that say and tell us what they saw. And we can rely on that testimony. They saw a man who was dead alive again. John was one of those people, the Apostle John. And he wrote down everything that he saw, as he says, so that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. We know that testimony is absolutely reliable because it wasn't just him saying it. No, the Holy Spirit had worked in his heart to believe the things that he saw. And the Holy Spirit worked through him to write, as he wrote down these things, so that the people who read about them, countless people have heard and believed. And our parents, grandparents, friends, or even complete strangers have testified to us about these things. And by God's grace, we have believed. By God's grace, he will help us overcome our doubts. And by believing, that peace which Jesus offered his disciples as he stood there in the middle of the room, that peace is ours. And it's not just a rest from conflict, but it's a wholeness, not that we can see, but a wholeness that comes from knowing that because that man who was dead is alive, things between us and God are all right, that, and even more than all right, they're perfect. And that is a message that we can share, that we can share with others. We can share that peace. We can tell them what we've heard and by God's grace what we've come to believe. We can be the type of reliable witnesses that Jesus' disciples were. So many people see faith and religion as incompatible, as contradictory. But we don't have to. But we do need to know what type of faith we have. And it's not blind faith, but it's not seen faith either. It's a faith that hears and believes the message about Jesus. And even though it is a difficult thing to believe what you can't see, we know that it won't always be that way. And that one day we will see him with our own eyes. May we pray. Heavenly Father, it is so easy to doubt. We deal with unreliable people and aren't always so reliable ourselves. So it's easy to forget how different you are. You are always faithful, and your word is completely reliable. Forgive our doubts, and by your Holy Spirit working through word and sacrament, we ask that you'd continue to strengthen our trust in you. Thank you, Lord, for giving us someone to believe in, Jesus Christ, our risen Savior. It's in his name we pray all of this. Amen. Please stand. The peace of God, which transcends all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We continue by confessing together our Christian faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. We'll continue now by giving our thanks to God with our financial offerings.
Last week, the Lord called home to himself the soul of our oldest member, B. Hansen, who was 101 years old at the time that the Lord called her to her new home. We now pray for her family. O Lord God, Lord of life and death, we thank you for all the mercies which you blessed our fellow believer, B. Hansen, who has now fallen asleep. We thank you especially for having brought her to the knowledge of your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray that you would comfort her family and all who mourn her death with your precious promises and cheer them with the sure hope of a blessed reunion in heaven. We ask that you would grant the lifeless body rest and at last, together with us all, a joyful resurrection to life everlasting. Teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain hearts of wisdom and finally be saved. Through Jesus Christ, our risen and ever-living Lord. Amen. Please rise for prayer. Lord God, thank you for all the blessings you give us. You are a good and gracious King, and treat us better than we deserve. We especially thank you today for the gift of the Holy Spirit. Savior, the spiritual enemies of our age have blinded the minds of so many people in our country and the world. They need someone to bring them the light of your word in order to free them from the darkness of their unbelief. Holy Spirit, you told us in your inspired word to pray on all occasions. Hear us now as we bring you our personal prayers. Hear us for Jesus' sake as we join to pray the prayer he has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We leave in the joy and strength of the Lord. We sing hymn number 341. We conclude our service by reading responsively Psalm number 16. Keep me safe, my God, for in you I take refuge.
I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing.
Lord, you alone are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken.
Therefore, my heart is glad, and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest secure.
Because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead, nor will you let your faithful one see decay.
You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy.
Receive now with believing hearts the Lord's benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated. We conclude with a last verse. Good morning, and once again, welcome to Beautiful Savior, especially if you happen to be one of our guests. If that is the case, we'd invite you to come back and worship with us again as you are able to do so. Well, we have three announcements.